In the 2005 FIFA U17 World Cup, there was a young Mexican footballer who completely stole the spotlight. Dazzling with his close control, lightning-fast acceleration, stunning skill, and leading his country of Mexico to their historic first-ever win, all while assisting twice in the final and winning the tournament's silver ball along the way. And this prodigy's name was Giovani Dos Santos. In fact, he was so good that Barcelona flew him halfway across the world, all the way from Mexico, to be selected into Barcelona's famed La Masia all the way back when he was 12 years old. And just to give you an idea of how hyped the young footballer was, if you look at World Soccer's 50 most exciting teenage footballers in 2007, at number 5, Giovani Dos Santos was ranked higher than players like Gareth Bale, Sergio Aguero, Angel Di Maria, Karim Benzema, Toni Kroos, Mesut Ozil, and Alexis Sanchez. And to make it even more legit, Giovani Dos Santos was a personal favorite of manager Frank Rijkaard, who saw his potential, and a younger brother and apprentice to the guy who many thought his game was similar to most, the then best player in the world, Ronaldinho. So promising that he was named up there in the conversation for Barcelona's brightest young talent. But despite all that, today he's largely forgotten. So just what happened? To really understand the Giovani Dos Santos hype and see why Barcelona decided to bet on him, we first have to go back to where it all started. In 2001, Mexico, along with 40 other countries, participated in an international youth tournament called the Danone Nations Cup, which was held in Paris. Mexico would make a surprise 5th-place finish, all thanks to the tournament top scorer and a Golden Boot winner, the 11-year-old Giovani Dos Santos. It was so impressive that Barcelona scouts decided to sign him, along with his younger brother, Jonathan Dos Santos, on board to their prestigious youth academy, La Masia. However, it was always Giovani that was seen as the more promising of the two. But at the time, in Mexican football, there was never really any young prodigies to have so much hype and even be accepted into a youth academy as big as Barcelona. And you know it's a big deal when you're being backed by one of the biggest organizations in the world. But don't worry, you can too with today's sponsor, Morgan & Morgan. Morgan & Morgan is America's largest injury firm with more than 800 attorneys nationwide. They've recovered over $15 billion for their clients. And the most amazing part is that you pay nothing up front for their services. Yes, you heard that right, the fee is completely free unless they help you win your claim. No upfront cost or sign-up fees. Your health and body is worth so much, and to risk never being able to play football again, or even just suffering through an injury, is definitely not worth it. So if you're ever injured in an accident, you can call Morgan & Morgan by dialing #law or 529 from your cell phone, or go to www.forthepeople.com/RaymarFootball and check out Morgan & Morgan to submit a claim. Thanks to Morgan & Morgan for sponsoring today's video. So in 2002, Giovani bid farewell to his family, leaving behind the comfort of his home, and made his journey to Barcelona in order to pursue his dream. Under Barcelona's esteemed coaches and alongside talented teammates, Giovani flourished in the nurturing environment of La Masia. His speed, dribbling, and ball handling quickly became evident. And just a year after Giovani had moved to Barcelona, they would sign Ronaldinho, who at the time was one of the best players in the world. And if you didn't know, La Masia students often get the opportunity to meet and train with Barcelona first team players. And it was during a training session that the young Giovani caught Ronaldinho's eye with his nimble footwork, raw talent, and wild playstyle. Ronaldinho would notice the brilliance of the young Mexican and would eventually take him under his wing. And not only did they share a similar flashy playstyle, but the same hair as well. Then, a couple years later, Ronaldinho would reach the peak of the footballing world when he won the 2005 Ballon d'Or with Barcelona. And coincidentally, this was also Giovani's breakout season in his youth years, as, like I mentioned, he would carry Mexico to their first ever under-17 World Cup trophy while winning the silver ball along the way. The comparisons couldn't have been made at a more perfect time. Dos Santos became a national sensation in his country, and to many, Giovani Dos Santos was quite literally the Mexican Ronaldinho. And with the heights that Ronaldinho reached, many looked to Giovani and expected the same thing. And back then, it was a completely legitimate expectation. The following year, Giovani Dos Santos would finally have the opportunity to move up to play in Barcelona B, as after all the recent success, he was seen as one of Barca's top 3 brightest prospects, alongside Bojan Krikic and, of course, Lionel Messi. Giovanni would then slowly start to impress Barca manager Frank Rijkaard, so much so that he would pull the 18-year-old from Barcelona B to finally join the ranks of the prestigious first team. Maybe now you could get a better picture of why there was so much hype around him. In fact, Frank Rijkaard saw so much potential in Giovanni that he let the teenager play over 1,000 minutes in his debut 2007-2008 season. But this is where things started to go downhill. Firstly, there were a lot of positional conflicts for Giovanni Dos Santos. Barca already had players like Lionel Messi and Boyan, which ultimately led to Dos Santos never really having a solid position. He would move around having different roles, whether it be a winger, forward, or a secondary striker, which meant he was never really able to establish himself on the pitch. But probably the biggest factor in his lack of success was ultimately his attitude. As Ronaldinho's apprentice, he would always try to be like him, but that didn't always necessarily apply on the pitch. There were rumors of how Dos Santos would pick up on Ronaldinho's wild nightlife and lifestyle, leading to overall less fitness and discipline, which would come back to affect him later in his career, as the two had similar playstyles, hairstyles, and loved to party. This was also one of the biggest criticisms of Ronaldinho's career, as after winning the Ballon d'Or and Champions League with Barcelona, his commitment and discipline with football had never been the same, and it kind of rubbed off on the young superstar Dos Santos. Being a hero for your country and a prodigy accepted into La Masia from a young age inflated the idea that maybe he could be like his idol Ronaldinho without having to work as hard. And I guess it's kind of ironic how one of Ronaldinho's apprentices would pick up on his behaviors outside of the pitch, while the other would use his mentorship to improve on his game even further. But after the end of the 2007-2008 season was a crucial time for Barcelona, as club management would sack Frank Rijkaard and put Pep Guardiola in charge, going through a massive change and getting rid of players like Ronaldinho and Deco while bringing in more committed players that Pep wanted, like Busquets, Dani Alves, and Gerard Piqué. Giovanni might have very well had the chance to stay with Barca for their treble-winning season, but seeing as Boyan had probably the greatest debut season of any Barcelona player ever, and Messi really breaking out into a star, Giovanni wanted more playtime and recognition, wanting to follow in Ronaldinho's footsteps. And instead of continuing to fight hard to get a spot in Barcelona's elite starting 11, Giovanni ultimately chose to leave the club, while his brother, Jonathan Dos Santos, would remain with Barca for several more years. Thus, Giovanni would make his way to the Premier League. Tottenham would sign the 19-year-old as they believed he had that insane potential. In fact, they signed Dos Santos and Modric in the same transfer window, as they had huge hopes that these two could one day turn the club around. However, this was when his attitude really started to affect him. Off-the-pitch controversies and concerns about his commitment to the game also plagued Giovanni. Reports of partying and a lack of discipline emerged, as Giovanni would often come to training late and spent a lot of his free time at nightclubs. The same attributes that had once made him Ronaldo's apprentice now appeared to be holding him back, hindering his growth and preventing him from reaching his full potential. And when you pair this lack of discipline with the fact that he was playing in a more physical and high-paced league, with a much weaker supporting midfield, Giovanni would begin to struggle heavily, never quite managing to recapture the magic he had once displayed on the pitch. And despite the occasional flashes of brilliance, he failed to consistently establish himself as a prominent role in the squad. And in just a span of 3 seasons, he would be loaned out from Tottenham to Ipswich Town in the Championship, then to Galatasaray in the Turkish Super League, then back to Spain for Racing Santander. His inability to settle down and find a stable environment really hampered his development. And as the years passed, Giovanni's career became a series of missed opportunities and unfilled potential. Failed transfers, underwhelming performances, and off-pitch distraction, struggling to make an impact and showcasing the skills that had once captivated audiences around the world. The relentless cycles of injuries and inconsistencies eroded his confidence, and the hype that had once surrounded him gradually faded into a distant memory. But at 26 years old, for the first time in his career, Giovanni Dos Santos finally started to make a comeback. He was in the best condition of his career, finally starting to dedicate himself fully to training. He would sign with respectable Spanish side Villarreal in 2013, having the best season of his career with 12 goals and 8 assists in 34 matches, roughly a 0.58 goal contributions per game, as it was his first of only 2 seasons in which he scored double-digit goals. Then after a couple of redemption seasons at Villarreal, Dos Santos would move to LA Galaxy in the MLS, where he would become a fan favorite and further improved his professionalism and made a full 180 from the attitude he had in his younger years. This was the most successful and stable run of Dos Santos' entire career. But unfortunately, a string of injuries he suffered in his most recent club, America, that required multiple surgeries would sideline Dos Santos for a very long time. And sadly, ever since 2021, he's been a free agent not playing for any club. And while it's easy to dwell on the disappointments and what-ifs of Giovanni's career, despite the lack of club success, Dos Santos helped win the gold medal for Mexico in the 2012 Olympics, along with three CONCACAF Gold Cups. So looking at his story, it's important to remember that every athlete faces unique challenges and obstacles along their journey. Talent alone is not enough to guarantee success. It takes dedication, perseverance, and it also requires you to look at yourself and make the changes to improve, which Dos Santos has managed to learn from. Though his path may have veered off course, his story serves as a reminder that redemption and reinvention are always possible, as long as you have the dedication and commitment to rise again.